Hey everybody, Mike Giardina here with CrossFit Health. We're here with Bill Anthes from Between the Ears. And we're gonna talk about some stuff that's maybe a little less focused on inside of the affiliate, which is why we wanna talk about it, to bring some attention to this, provide some ways to, you know, create some focus on maybe what we call mental health or mental fitness, becoming mentally stronger, resilience, those types of things. But by using CrossFit methodology and using some of the tools that are accessible within the affiliate. Is that pretty fair, Bill? Essentially what we'll be talking about.
I love it.
I think
it's very fair. Yeah, I love it.
But before we get started, why don't you tell me a little bit about yourself, Bill? Tell me, like, you know, not necessarily about Between the Ears yet, but a little bit about your background. How'd you get to here? Like, what's your background?
Yeah. So my background is an athlete. You know, I played soccer my whole life at, you know, very high club level through into college. Was fortunate enough to have great coaches along the way and a good teammates. Finished my career in college as a first team All-American. You know, really just loved the whole notion of being an athlete, being part of something. And then, of course, every athlete has the final whistle, and nobody thinks about what happens after that, which is, you know, somewhat jarring for some. You know, and so this was probably 2007 timeframe, was my final season, my final year in college, and I didn't know really like what I was going to do next. I wanted to go into the military, wasn't really sure about it, all these different things. Decided to go into public accounting. That was my major. And
interesting.
Yeah, not that interesting. A curious choice.
Interesting decision. Maybe not an interesting profession to you.
Exactly.
Maybe to some people.
Yes.
In it. Right.
Hey, we need them. They're wonderful. I was the wrong person for that job.
Right.
And then it got to a decision point where it's like, hey, either do the military thing, which is something I wanted to do my whole life, or never think about it again. And I wasn't prepared at 25 to feel like I would have regretted or failed something simply because of not trying. So I quit my job, joined the Army with the hopes and dreams of becoming a Green Beret, enlisted into the Army to do that, successfully became a Green Beret, served in Special Forces.
It's awesome.
And
Thank
then,
you.
No, it's an honor and a privilege, really. And then I got out after my enlistment contract was over to be with my family. Out here in New Jersey, and my wife Kariana, she's been in CrossFit forever, you know, 15-year affiliate owner,
staple in CrossFit for sure. Absolutely. Yeah.
She's definitely, you know, been around for a long time, and just came back and was like, all right, get into fitness. And, you know, CrossFit was a thread line throughout all of my military time. And it really filled that void after the final whistle where, even though I wasn't really in an active affiliate setting, because like this was, you know, before there was a lot of them. And then finally, I moved home right before I went to basic training. And that was like the first time I went into a CrossFit gym, a proper CrossFit affiliate, which was awesome. And it changed my life and met my wife there. And here we are today.
Yeah, that's awesome. Yeah. No, I think there are a couple, you know, relatable things there on my end. One, I am entering the world of competitive soccer as a parent, but with a youngster, right? So she's 11 and just made the competitive team versus the rec team, right? So getting a chance to experience that life, which is, you know, it's ramping up and it's going to be interesting. But I'm pumped for her, so that's cool. And then the, like, what am I going to do next when some type of sport or competitive, we'll call it, career ends, right? And I think I went through that quite a bit after many years of competing at a, you know, at then it's a high level. I mean, it's not the level it is now in CrossFit, but a high level in CrossFit. Yeah. And then, you know, realizing that I just couldn't do it anymore. So yeah, no, I totally get that. And then it's like, okay, well, that kind of defines me. Now what do I do? You know, and yeah, it doesn't have to define you, but you think it does. So that's really interesting. Cool. Yeah. So so that's like how you got to this point. And so tell me a little bit about yourself now, like what, you know, you guys have between the ears, but you know, what led to that? I know you went out and you pursued further education past accounting. Let's talk a little bit about that. Like what led you to these life changes to pursue what you're doing now?
Yeah, sure. So when I got out of the military, I wanted to somehow bring shared experiences, or I thought valuable lessons from a lifetime of being an athlete, a competitive athlete, both in sport and in, you know, a tactical athlete or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But I didn't want to do, I didn't want to make it seem like there's plenty of opportunities out there for people to go to events that simulate what it's like to be perhaps in like a military selection course. Sure. There's nothing wrong with those. That's just not my jam. Like that's just not my style. But there are some experiences and principles that you know, encounter during those experiences that are really valuable. And I really wanted to provide folks like a dose of that without having them, one, either go to one of these events or have to like quit their job and go to the army and, you know, say goodbye to their family and say, hey, I'm gonna go find myself. So that kind of, so that kind of led to just creating something that was a combination of physical movement and mindset or psychology type work. And, you know, what the unknown and challenging physical environments are really wonderful teachers. And just started with an event that said, hey, show up at the gym Friday, 10 o'clock at night, if you want to challenge yourself. And people showed up, and it was like there was no barbells or kettlebells. It was like outside of the gym stuff, and people showed up, and that was really cool. And I got a lot of feedback on that. And that started this sort of scent trail of, hey, I think there's something here that people are interested in, that they understand when they challenge themselves and also challenge their norm. Like CrossFit's full of people who regularly challenge themselves, which is wonderful. But like the variance piece that you have to sort of delegate or have someone else provide for you outside of the gym stuff. And, you know, that for a couple of years, it was just like running events, working with people. And then it started to get a little bit deeper, a little bit more personal, different as I was kind of going through my own personal journey, as well as continuing to educate on, hey, what's actually happening here? Like, let me start to learn maybe some of the neuroscience, some of the psychology, some of that stuff. And there was one of our friends actually did one of our events, and it was like very powerful for her. But she had said like she didn't want to look at me afterwards. And it was like the look on her face was like, wow, we're like not really friends in this moment, which is okay. I'm all right with that. But like, I hope she's okay. And she's like, hey, you know, if you're going to keep doing this, like you have to remember that there's a responsibility that comes with like opening some doors and opening some boxes, and like, just think about that. And I was like, noted, like, thank you.
Interesting.
That was some of the best feedback I've ever gotten, because I didn't understand exactly what was going on at the time. And I didn't also know what somebody else had going on in their life.
Yeah.
Not that you can know for sure. But when we start to do this stuff, you know, people uncover things. And that kind of really, I think, was a very intense spark to go down the formal route of mental health, and decided to go back to get my master's degree in social work, and really look to work with people who are looking for actual clinical psychotherapy, trauma work, all of that. And that's what I do now as well as a trauma therapist.
Wow, that's really interesting. That's I didn't know that that was the story that led you to this.
Yeah.
So you essentially, you had something that was working and you had this experience. And I feel like, you know, this tends to happen in a lot of other areas. Even something like research, where like you find something that works and you're like, okay, this is working, but now we got to figure out why. And, you know, that kind of leads to, but for like, that leads to research and, you know, all those different things that can help explain. But we kind of had the same approach with you as you were using this, like, you know, you knew it worked, you saw that it worked. Somebody had a statement that made you think, okay, well, there's more responsibility here. And there's, I need to really understand why. And then, you know, how to guide people through this, you know, more effectively, maybe. And that led you into this pursuit of being a therapist. That's cool, man. Like, that's really interesting. Yeah. So here we are. And now you have this company, it's Between the Ears. And tell me about it. Like, what do you guys do? You know, like what we've scratched the surface. We're using a challenge, you know, ways to challenge yourself within the walls of the gym. You know, as a way, I guess, to like, how's, you know, translate out into what goes on outside of the gym. But like, what does that mean? What are you guys doing? How does this work?
Yeah. I really wish I had a clear sentence to say, like, our elevator pitch is we don't have an elevator pitch,
which is great.
You know, it's just like, what do you do? And what we've kind of temporarily parked on, but the engine's still running, is we explore the physiology of psychology. And what we mean by that is, you know, so CrossFit, constantly varied functional movements executed at high intensity, comma, relative to physical and psychological tolerances. And that relative to psychological tolerances was really the, for me and personally, like the thing that was always most interesting to me.
The hardest to assess too, right? It's easier to assess somebody's physical tolerances, whether it's, you know, some type of movement limitation, fitness level, injuries. There are all these things that physically are a lot easier to say, well, hey, I'm going to, you know, scale or create a workout or whatever based off of these physical limitations. But having some way to assess psychological limitations and then provide the right stimulus to meet those or go slightly past those so that there's some improvement there, that's a lot harder, right? I mean, I'm assuming that's what you're talking about here.
Yeah. And I think that's one of the challenges with that I was experiencing. Well, okay, this thing is going really well, but there isn't any battery meter that you can just look at and be like, oh, you're at like 25%. Like, it's time to plug in. Like, we wish there was, but if somebody came walking in like with a limp, you'd be like, you all right? They're like, yeah, I just did like, you know, the deadlift medley yesterday though. So like, I'm not gonna be able to walk for, you know, 3 years. And you're like, oh, okay, right on. We could hook you up. But, you know, consciousness can't be observed. But we all know it exists. And and it really is, it's a tough thing. It's a tough nut to crack with folks. And we certainly don't claim to have it figured out. But what we do try to do is look at, for sure, look at like the nervous system, look at somebody, how they're sleeping, how they're eating, what their new, you know, obviously their nutrition is like,
sure,
what their interest is as far as, you know, agency and commitment into their own pursuits. So we really try to have as many questions and lines of inquiry that we can, that also uses, like, we're limited to the use of language and some of the realm in which really challenges people psychologically can't be accessed by language, you know, and
sure.
And that's sometimes really a difficult thing for somebody who's like, hey, I'm going to come and like, I still want to get fit. I still want to work out. So we've kind of developed like a model and a little bit of a system that tries to raise awareness of people's nervous system, of what they have going on in life, you know. So we had somebody who was like pitching, like a, you know, C-suite person who was having a huge pitch one day. Felt good, but like, that's probably not the day, 3 hours before a big meeting, to go see how close to the sun you can fly, right? Mm-hmm. So we're like, mm-hmm. hey, let's have something that, you know, isn't going to go too wild on you, because you've got this more important thing coming up in about 3 hours.
Mm-hmm.
So really trying to make some, I hate to use the word like bespoke, but it is sort of like an individualized way of trying to sort of address the psychological tolerances component, you know, looking at people's stress. Obviously their mental health is going to be a component of that. All so that we can have a proactive approach to really combining mental health and physical fitness and sure. bringing them together. You know, that's kind of like the physiology of psychology thing.
And how does this work? Like, okay, so when we'll get into the methods, and what I mean by methods is like in-person events, the dose, you know, mm-hmm. You know, these other ways that people can, you know, all the different ways people can work with you to do this. But mm-hmm. I'm assuming regardless of all those, like there are workouts, there's some type of check-in that, you know, internal, you know, there's some type of check-in that takes place. There's, you know, with that information, something that's applied to the workout. And then, you know, after the workout, there's some type of reflection that happens in order to bring that experience in, you know, outside of the gym, you know, and I'm spitballing here. I'm assuming this is how it happens, but can you walk me through, like, you know, what do you guys do? And is this something that somebody at an affiliate, you know, out here in Carlsbad, who's doing the workout of the day in their gym, can apply? Or is it specific to workouts that Between the Ears comes up with? And I know that's a lot. Let's start off with, how does this work? Pre-workout, workout, post-workout.
So I think the best thing that we certainly don't have a trademark on adjusting what someone does physically mm-hmm. to nest with their mental state. Like that's, we don't own that.
Yeah.
One of the sort of progressions that we follow, maybe the principle that we kind of go by, is we first start with like, hey, let's just like check in, and we're just going to check in physically, mentally, emotionally, and having a little bit of a, you know, a little bit of a criteria for that. So we're thinking about how, you know, how did we sleep? What's our soreness level like? What's our energy? What's the quality of our thinking like? Are we brain fog? Is it just like, I forgot to bring my shoes today? Or is it like, no, I'm dialed in. I'm like seeing the wind, like we're ready to rock and roll. And then emotionally, you know, how are we doing? Are we numb, disconnected, frozen a little bit? Are we agitated? Is there something just sort of like a pebble in the shoe situation? Or is it like, hey, today is the world's greatest day? Those are all signals mm-hmm. that are informing us about the state of our nervous system, the state of our, you know, our body and our intentions, our capacity, right? What we can perhaps tolerate on today, maybe going to be different than what we can tolerate, you know, 2 or 3 days from now. So we want to raise awareness. After we raise awareness, we really want to sort of look at just setting an intention, and an intention with oneself. How do you want to approach the workout? Not necessarily why you want to do the workout. Why is great, but it kind of limits you to what you already know. And that's necessary. However, when we look at conducting a workout and setting an intention through a how, that's kind of a more expanded view, an expanded field. So for example, if someone's doing, let's just say like they're doing like Jackie or something.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. And they're like, okay, you know, they're doing okay. They're fine. Right. Everybody usually says like, we have a color coding system. People are like, yeah, I'm fine. Like yellow. It's like, ugh. Well, yellow can literally mean anything. So, hey, what's an intention for this? And if they're saying, well, I want to, you know, if they're new and they say I want to burn down a 2K row, or is it a 2 or 1? 1K row?
1K, yeah.
1K, right? It's like, all right, well, you know, sure, maybe you do that, and you learn the hard way what that tastes like. But you know, what's your intention for this workout? How, not necessarily like what do you want to do total time wise, but how do you want to show up and engage with that workout?
Yeah.
And that's going to really be a telling bit of information. Usually people first say it with their eyes. Like if you watch them in the face, they're like, you know, they look down, they kind of get up a little bit.
Yeah.
And you're like, yeah, that's not going to be the day for a PR, right? Or when people are like locked in and,
yeah,
and there's no deviation, they're like, I'm going for it. Like, all right, cool, let's do it. So raise awareness, set an intention. Of course, we execute. And we wrap it up with an introspection and a reflection or a processing. And this isn't like a group share or anything like that. We do encourage people to journal after. It's like a nice way of also like cooling down, like guilty as charged. Like you do the workout and you're like, all right, cool. I got like 3 minutes before I got to go. Well, you know, let's like cool down. Let's process. Let's kind of just dump some thoughts down, whatever came up. And that's like a repeatable process, raise awareness, set an intention, execute and process, that I think when people do that, they really can start to teach themselves about how they're showing up, what their days are like, and having a practice that is both physical and kind of psychological. It's both physical in the execution and psychological in terms of like the introspection element, which is critical, which is huge, especially for, you know, I mean, in a clinical standpoint as well. Like we have to talk about things, yes, but we also have to do things, you know.
That's awesome. I mean, that's so, let's go back to, I don't know if you remember, if he said he was a like a higher level executive, but you have this guy that's I think he was a higher level executive, and he has this presentation to do that's like, you know, it's a big presentation. Are these tools and these processes, are they things that you bring outside of the gym to other events, like something like that? Would you apply the same procedure? I'm going to start off and do some self-reflection. What do I want to get out of this? What is the intention of this? You know, what is my performance going to be like here? And then some type of, you know, takeaway at the end. Is that like part of the process, is taking this approach and applying it to other areas? Or is this something that's very specific to the gym and working out?
I think both, really. You know, yeah. I think in one sense, like for the normal sort of working out every day kind of thing, it's a great practice to have. It costs no money. There's no on or off button to do it. And only you can do it. And if you do it honestly, then beautiful. A lot of times people say like, hey, how should I do this workout? Or like if it's a dose thing or something. And it's like, hey, did you have an intention for it? They're like, yeah, this is what I had. I'm like, then you did it right. My flavor, my spin on it might be a little bit different. Yours, different deal. So if you had an honest intention with it, then like, yeah, beautiful, right on. And that's really one of the things that goes into working with people, I think, with a mental health, mental performance, mental fitness mindset, whatever we're calling it, but really encouraging people to express the process of having agency. Okay. And, you know, we have like a seminar, which is, it's funny, it's an experience more than like it's an educational thing for sure, but like it is an experience for people first. Like we want you to experience this as an individual first, especially coaches. Coaches are great at being like, I can't wait to bring this to my members, I can't wait to bring this to my athletes. And it's like, hey, administer first, self-administer, feel it first, continue to explore. So for, you know, different types of events, different types of experiences that we offer, it does differ a little bit. But that's generally what we want to see, is encouraging people to really honor and express their agency, the ability to choose among choices. And for some, I get it. It's a lot easier sometimes when you're just like, hey, just tell me what to do.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there's value to that for sure. But if we're thinking about really trying to tackle some of the mental health or the mindset or the mental performance stuff, we need to really look at dialing up the individual's agency or teaching them how to go through that practice. And it's not easy. You know, it really isn't, but you know, we're a community of people who don't exactly shy away from doing hard things either.
Totally. And so I get like, so that's the takeaway, right? Agency. That's the takeaway is, you know, making choices for yourself and kind of understanding your needs, and it's mm-hmm. making those choices, right? So that's how have you seen this impact long-term, let's call them behaviors or mental health with, you know, obviously I know there's some privacy things here. We don't have to use anybody's, you know, get super specific with anybody, but just some general like results that you've seen.
I think the most consistent across unique people, because, you know, and that's the beauty about this. That's the beauty about CrossFit affiliates. It's a beauty about, you know, fitness. There's such a diversity and a uniqueness among people that we get to work with. One of the things along, I would say all of them, is this sense of trust and belief in self. I think that's really what it comes down to when we see this consistently applied. And
that's big.
It's huge. It's huge. And you're like, hell yeah. Now to where, you know, so when we allow ourselves to have an experience,
mm-hmm.
that could be a very difficult, challenging experience. But if we're allowing ourselves to have it, you know, we're not living in denial. We're living in allowance. And yeah, that mm-hmm. might be like really rough to do. But so many times, you know, and it's no fault of anybody's, but we see this with people where it's like, hey, today is, let's just say Jackie. And we're going to try to, like, you know, you're going to pace the thing or the row. Don't even consider putting the barbell down and hold on for dear life on the pull-ups, right? To whatever your capacity is. And like, we're going for it. Beautiful workout, great workout. Well, if somebody's not really like going to go for it that day, or if they're struggling to do that and they go into an environment where everybody's going for it, they're human, their nervous systems, right, is going to respond to that and be like, ah, maybe I'm going to go for it.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we all, I think everybody, we all succumb to that at times,
mm-hmm.
but when you start to kind of peel it back a little bit, it's like, hey, what's going on that, what does it say about you? Or what do you think it says about you? If you don't go full send today,
mm-hmm.
if you pull back a little bit, we're not saying, you know, don't do anything, right? Continue to move. And when people are able to go into that and say, like, hey, right on, awesome, I'm doing me. I have that trust in self where I can follow through on what I know kind of to be right and true to me in this moment. And allowing them to have that experience and realize it's not going to define them or, you know, be a hit to their identity or anything like that. The amount of trust and belief in self really is what starts.
That's a struggle,
which is beautiful.
That's a struggle. I mean, you know, like getting to that point, you know, cause I think,
mm-hmm.
you know, we all are concerned with sometimes less about our own needs or, you know, and more about how other people see us, or I don't want to say judge us, but see us, and we're willing to sacrifice sometimes our own needs just to be that other person that we think that they want us to be. So I see how that's really cool. That's awesome. This is awesome because, you know, we've had a couple of conversations prior to this, but I'm really getting a full grasp of your approach here. And I dig it. I mean, I think it's awesome. You know, what's interesting is like, gosh, you know, I think if anybody's been doing CrossFit long enough, you've experienced some type of improvement, you know, likely, I'm not going to say everybody, but you've likely experienced some type of improvement in, you know, mental health, confidence, whatever you want to call it, right? But maybe didn't know why or know how it happened. And so I'm assuming also, like, this just gives some really good framework to get the most out of that. You know, it's cool. Like, you guys are called between the ears, and what was that? It was a very, you know, old thing that, you know, Greg Glassman used to say, is like, the biggest adaptation to CrossFit probably happens between the years. And it's like, well, yeah, but like, let's, you know, what I think what you guys are doing is like, well, let's maximize that. Let's really figure out how to, you know, how to, because it's much easier to say, how am I going to get the most out of this workout physically? You know, like, mm-hmm. every day I'm just going to, you know, I'm going to do this. I'm going to hit it hard. I'm going to scale this way. I want to put 10 more pounds on my back squat today. So I PR. And it's like, well, you know, like, well, how are we going to get the most out of this, you know, mentally? Right. And you know, the way it sounds, the way I can see it is like, man, you know, if you can tap into that, like, the physical stuff's going to happen, you know, mm-hmm. when you really tap into that, you know, and you understand, like, well, today's the day, mm-hmm. we'll go after it today, you know, and you can go, like you said, you can go full send and just tear that sucker down. Or it's like, well, today's not today, but what is the intention today? How can I get other improvements from this workout? That's not like, you know, burning it down. You know, how else can I get that's cool, man. That's really cool.
Yeah. Yeah.
So you know, like, what you talked about the experience, you know, I call it a seminar, but you, like you said, it's more of an mm-hmm. experience. And that's, mm-hmm. is that something you say, hey, this would be better, like, that's better for coaches, or is that really open to anybody? But if you're a coach and you want to implement this, you should be doing the experience first, so you could have this experience on yourself and then start figuring out how to apply it to athletes. Like, who's that for, and what does that look like? Is it 1 day, 2 days?
Yeah. So, I mean, it's tough to say, because I think coaches would absolutely benefit from it, because they are a connection point to others. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they are force multipliers. So for coaches to go through it and experience it, you know, we've had quite a few coaches and affiliate owners be like, oh, like, I get it now. Between the ears isn't just doing some of the crazy stuff that you like, because there is a little bit of this thing where it can sound like, oh, well, all you're doing is telling people to take it easy. We're like, no, but if you're going to take it easy, take it easy. But there's a lot, there's quite a few things that we've done. It's like, oh, this is like, no, of course I'm not going to even attempt to do this. Like, cause we're going to say, hey, let's, you know, the margins of our experience, right on, let's try to go beyond there. So for coaches who have taken the seminar and gone through it, they realize, like, I got it. It's not just some crazy shit that you guys do.
Yeah.
Even though it's difficult and whatever, because anybody can make the world's hardest workout. Like, that requires very little skill. Totally. You know, in the military, we had a thing. It was like the world's heaviest pencil, and you held it out. You just held a straight arm out in front, and like that pencil turned from like whatever, you know, 0.3 ounces to 400 pound static hold. Right. And it takes no talent, skill to do that. So for the seminar, it's great for athletes also who are looking to, hey, how can I more intentionally perhaps train my psychological tolerances? Mm-hmm. And we kind of dive into that. We dive into some of the neuroscience with it, some of the, you know, psychology, some of the nervous system implications. It's not a neuroscience course, though. It's not a, you know, exercise science or, you know, biochemistry or, you know, pharmacology. It's not so deep into there, but we do have to address, like, all right, well, mental health and mindset exists beyond just the cognitive level. And we can't just reframe and think. There's nothing wrong with that. Those are effective tools and appropriate to do given a certain situation. But there is this implicitness to it, and this deeper influences. And that's where we really want to have people experience it.
That's cool.
Yeah, you can read all about fire, but you don't know what it feels like until you put your hand in a flame. And that's kind of what informs how we do the seminar.
And how often are you guys doing these seminars now? And are they like weekend seminars, 2 days, one day?
Yeah, 2 days. Yeah, it's a 2 day. It's a 2 day, you know, like I said, highly experiential, to the point of the guy actually with the our client the other day with the presentation. There's a certain finishing experience we do that has a tool and the thing that we use. And that's kind of like it's kind of like a psychedelic experience without the psychedelics.
Yeah.
And you know, we've had people have some very intense visuals and
really
senses of like peace and unity. Yeah. Yeah. Wild. As well as it being like very difficult. There's like me and personally, I've had a difficult experience in multiple domains, but and really what we are looking to do is to not just, you know, blow the doors off of somebody. You know, we have this thing where we say like we're teachers, not breachers. Yeah. And in my former profession, blowing doors and breaching, and that was like, yeah, that was something you have to do. And typically when you do that, the person on the other end, it's like, hello, wake up.
Yeah, yeah.
But in our domain, and when we bring mental health into an affiliate or into a gym setting, which is beautifully positioned to be a truly a community mental health center and mm-hmm. physical fitness and health. And, you know, doctor, who was it? Chris, what was his name again? Palmer.
Yeah.
Like it's all there, you know, yeah. And every study yeah. says, hey, new and novel treatment approaches are required. Okay. Well, where's the new and where's the novel interventions, right? And that's where yeah. I think CrossFit affiliates are like, oh, the infrastructure is there. There's totally. Social setting, there's physical fitness, there's nutrition.
It's all there. Yeah.
But we want to teach, not breach. And that's if cool. we go too fast, especially with people who have trauma, who is like very few escape this thing unscathed. Totally. And if we go too fast with a mental health kind of informed thing, you know, it's almost like when you remember when you're in school and you did the like egg on the spoon races.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep.
That's kind of how it is. Like
yeah.
you take it you easy. Really want to get to the yeah. end, right? You want to beat the guy next or person next to you. But if you had a huge spoon, you're good to go.
Yeah.
So, you know, in therapy and counseling, it's like, hey, that's kind of like building our container. And that's tolerance, right? What we can, those very intense feelings and thoughts so not that we're able to tolerate, the more that we can, through safe, connected exposure, we can build that thing. So we're not going with the yeah, spork, but we're going with the frying pan.
Right.
You know, and that's, I think one of the things with that is, with this seminar, really having that education, but not overwhelming, and having people be like, listen, I'm not a therapist. I have no interest in being one. I want to train people. And I get that, right? Like scope of practice for sure.
Cool. And I like that.
The challenge is, yeah. I mean, the challenge is like, well, just, but your people are coming in with these things mm-hmm. anyway, back to the point of, well, why wouldn't somebody be able to do X, Y, or Z? Or why was it enough? So whether you like it or not, the mental component of it is walking itself into the gym. And if we can arm and equip coaches with some education, some tools, some ways of being, as well as being honest about scope of practice, totally. We feel like we can help.
Well, I think it's teaching coaches to realize, you know, the depth and breadth of their tool set, right? And I think right now maybe they don't know that. They think this is how big their, you know, their tool set is. And it's like it's actually a little mm-hmm. bit bigger here. But there yeah. might be some things that lie outside of it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And yeah. and that's when we might have to refer out to
yeah.
you know, a specialist. But there are a lot of things that you can do to help people in this area that's like mm-hmm. built within the walls of the affiliate that I don't think a lot of coaches realize. All right, cool. Yeah. So that's the 2 day experience. And I do believe there's one coming to California soon.
There is.
So that'll be yeah. really awesome. Yeah. And then tell me about some of the other experiences.
So we have an online program we call The Dose, and we, it's one workout a week. It's a unique, different type of workout. The workout is really the physical representation of this mindset or this concept.
Mm-hmm.
Intention, we can say, whatever. Mm-hmm. And there's a write-up. There's like a, we talk about what the concept is for that day or for that, that workout is, expand upon it a little bit, gets people thinking. And then there's like an awareness section, which is some guided journal prompts to just kind of have that process and that mm-hmm. reflect thing, kind of like the end of it. And so it's one workout a week. It's definitely different and unique, and it changes all the time. Like, it's not going to be the same style every single time. And we also feel like it's very accessible for someone who, because mm-hmm. we've had this where people like, look, hey, I want to like get involved. I want to do things, but like, I also want to go and I'm also going to my affiliate, or I'm also, you know, I'm doing mayhem, or I'm doing this, or I'm doing sure. that. And, you know, of course there's like, you gotta, I think, right. Like, be aware of what the reality of the environment's like.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's not competing with anyone. It's not going to most likely compete with anything, but it's going to be a weekly dose of people to have an experience that combines the physical, which is like the access point for the psychological.
Mm-hmm.
And it's been going really well. You know, it's cool to see people realize like, oh, I'm applying this not just to workouts.
Yeah. Yeah.
Without it being, you know, because you can read a bunch of stuff in books, but no book is ever going to feel like having the heart pumping or,
totally.
You know, doing something that's a 90 minute workout. And you're like, man, that's 17 minutes. I'm already looking to leave.
I saw the one for this week. Looks good.
Yes.
Looks
yes.
good. Got to go find a sled.
Yeah.
That's awesome. And now can people, so, you know, the weekend seminar, the dose, kind of a weekly dose, you know, experience. Do you also have a practice that's open to people to work with you directly? Is that an in-person thing? Do you have something that works virtually with that as well?
Yeah, I do some coaching. I'm obviously a therapist, so I prefer to do in-person mm-hmm. therapy. And, you know, there's some legalities with state lines and whatnot. But I do coaching as well with people,
gotcha.
You know, for those who are interested in, yeah. you know, hey, I want to do some personal stuff. I want to have it a little bit, be more specific and, you know, work individually. Yeah, I definitely do that too.
That's awesome. Well, Bill, man, this has been incredible. And I know we're only scratching the surface, but I think it's a really yeah. good, you know, a good baseline of information on, you know, what you guys do and the value you add to, you know, just athletes, people in the gym, but also coaches and affiliate owners. Let's end it with this, because I think there's still a lot of information that people mm-hmm. can get, a ton of information that people can get from you guys. Where can they go to learn more, whether it's just about what you do, it's about getting involved with the weekend experience, or getting involved with the dose? How can they access you?
So, and I thank you. Really, that does mean a ton. Appreciate that. BetweenTheEars.com is a great place to go. BTWN TheEars. BTWN.com. That's our website that has, we think, hopefully as much possible. But, you know, don't expect a lot of words, because, again, some of the stuff is beyond language. Mm-hmm. And then on social media, at Between the Ears or at Bill Anthes or Kariana Anthes, to get kind of like a sampling as far as the social media. Yeah.
Awesome. Awesome. And we'll link the website and stuff. And man, I got to tell you, like, after talking to you about this, like, I want to do it.
Yeah, know? Buddy.
I want to experience it. It sounds really cool. I can see the, you know, efficacy behind it, like how this works. You know, just talking to you, when we really started talking about making the right choices for yourself, you know, based on your needs, but really like having a way to figure out what those needs are and, you know, learning that in this environment, but then applying it in other areas of life. Like,
yeah,
that's valuable. That's valuable.
We hope so. Yeah. And I think it's worth mentioning that it's not for everyone, and totally. That's okay. You know, yeah. And that's like right on, you know, it's not for everyone. There's some people who are going to be like, I hate this. And yeah, there might be like, if you aren't really open-minded or curious, or if you think you've got it all figured out, like for sure, you're not going to like it. But we have a pretty anti-dogmatic approach. And for those who are looking, you know, for something different or new or fresh or whatever it might be, those are the folks who usually, you know, the willing and the able. The willing is usually the sticking point. You know, the ability that could always be figured out. The the willingness, though, well, that's a different chat.
That's the hard one. Yeah. Awesome. Well, man, thank you so much. This has been great. And I'm looking forward to, you know, talking to you more and experiencing this and doing more together. So thank you so much. It's great.
Mike, appreciate it so much, man. Really enjoy the chat. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you.